Now, let's talk about chronic pancreatitis. Okay, this is another part of today's lecture, chronic pancreatitis. Now, what is the definition? This is a chronic inflammation or recurrent acute pancreatitis, which is causing irreversible parenchymal fibrosis, destruction of the gland, and calcification formation in the gland, leading to loss of endocrine and exocrine function. This is chronic pancreatitis. So see there, what is the difference from the acute pancreatitis? Acute pancreatitis is about acute inflammation of the pancreas. There is no permanent destruction or there is no irreversible damage done to the pancreas. But here, this is irreversible damage. Okay? Probably pancreas is not going back to its normal function after chronic pancreatitis is diagnosed. And it leads to both loss of endocrine and exocrine function. Now, exocrine function is all about pancreatic juice and function of those enzymes. So, mainly about the digestion and absorption of the food. Whereas, endocrine function is like insulin, glucagon, okay, somatostatin, and those important type of hormones. So, don't be surprised if a chronic pancreatitis patient presents with diabetes. This is known as secondary diabetes because of damage to the endocrine part of the pancreas. And don't be surprised if the same patient presents with malabsorption because of no pancreatic juice which is flowing into the duodenum. Now see that I'm providing you a concept right now so that you know later on it will be easy for you. What are the etiology? Most commonly it is caused by alcohol abuse in 70% of the cases. So, alcohol is responsible for acute pancreatitis as well as chronic pancreatitis. In some other 20% of the cases, this is idiopathic, we do not know. And other 10% of the time, you have hyperparathyroidism, which is causing hypercalcemia, hypertriglyceridemia, congenital pancreatic anomaly, okay, like annular pancreas, and pancreatic dwarfism. In the beginning of the class, I talked about those two things, annular pancreas and pancreatic dwarfism, and hereditary factors as well as obstruction of the pancreatic duct by the gallstone can also be responsible. Let's move on. Now, what is the pathophysiology of chronic pancreatitis? So let's quickly go through it. There is progressive inflammatory changes inside the pancreas. This inflammatory changes keep on happening, okay, repeatedly, which results in chronic irreversible inflammation. That results in fibrosis with calcification, and that leads to destruction of the pancreatic gland and leading to loss of pancreatic function, both exocrine as well as endocrine part. Now, what are the signs and symptoms or clinical features? So there is recurrent or constant epigastric or back pain, a bit similar to the acute pancreatitis. There is features of malabsorption or malnutrition. This is related to the exocrine dysfunction. Okay, just now we talked about this. Steatorrhea. Okay, what is steatorrhea? What do you mean by that? You can say, very good, you can say fat malabsorption. If our stool contains more fat, that is called steatorrhea. Steatorrhea is presence of excessive fat in the stool. Now, why that is happening? Very easy to explain. Because of exocrine dysfunction of the pancreas, the pancreatic juice has failed to produce or secrete. So there are not enzymes which are necessary for the digestion and absorption of the fat. So fat is, getting excreted in the stool. Along with that, fat-soluble vitamins are also not absorbed. So fat-soluble vitamin deficiency occur, like vitamin A, D, E, and K. These are fat-soluble vitamins. So there is a problem with that. Diabetes. Okay, This is an endocrine dysfunction of chronic pancreatitis. This is known as secondary diabetes mellitus, and polyuria is a feature of diabetes itself. Now, how to diagnose it? Okay, let's talk about it. The first thing is history. History and physical examination. Now, see that the different, you know, risk factor you need to ask to the patient. Okay, physical examination and investigation, all of them form a part of diagnosis. So fecal fat analysis has to be done. Okay, fecal fat analysis. Ask the patient about the excretion of fat in the stool. Now, how I know that from the history? Anybody? How I know patient is having steatorrhea from the history? What I ask?
Either stool is slippery and greasy like, and foul smelling.
Exactly. He's absolutely correct. I explained this point, in the past also. The steatorrhea stool looks bulky. Okay. It is looking bulky. Then it is very sticky. Okay. There are presence of fat droplets there, and it is difficult to flush. These are the features, and it is a bit of foul smelling as well than the normal one. So these are the features of steatorrhea. X-ray should be done. Just KUV X-ray can be done to rule out pancreatic calcification. Okay, KUV X-ray, kidney, ureter, bladder X-ray. Calcification is very common in chronic pancreatitis. ERCP should be done. Okay, to check for the ductal irregularities with dilation and stenosis. This is known as chain of legs pattern. Now, what we do, take imaging with the help of ERCP. We do this endoscopic procedure and inject some dye there, and then take the radiological assessment. We will see chain of legs pattern there because of ductal irregularity with dilation and stenosis. And if we do CT, there will be formation of pseudocyst. Okay, there is atrophy of the gland in some area, some other area there will be enlargement of the gland, there is calcification, and some of the masses also, which are seen by CT. Okay, now along with that, history taking is important. So please understand, these are not a part of history taking. So this history taking is a separate part of the diagnostic process. And one important point written, gallstones are not a common cause of chronic pancreatitis. They are important cause of acute, but in some of the cases, they may be causing chronic pancreatitis as well. Now see here how it looks in the abdominal X-ray. Though it has got a limited role, but if there are extensive calcification occurring, we can see it. If this type of feature is shown, without any doubt, we think, which is this area here? Look, it is arranging like a pancreas. Okay, pancreas. So a lot of calcification in the pancreas. This is a case of chronic pancreatitis. And this is the abdominal CT, okay, which is showing calcification again in this area. Now, what are the differential diagnosis of chronic pancreatitis? There may be some related pathologies there in that area or in the abdomen. You can write those very easily. Peptic ulcer disease, chronic type of condition, pancreatic cancer, okay, pancreatic cancer or cancer of head of the pancreas, and biliary tract diseases like cholecystitis may be considered as a differential diagnosis because of the pain. Okay, important point. Now, indications for surgery in case of chronic pancreatitis are persistent pain in the patient, gastrointestinal or biliary obstruction by the pancreas or those related pathology, pseudocyst infection, hemorrhage or rupture, and enlarging pseudocyst causing a lot of compression in that area. In this case, we should go for surgery and relieve those pathological process. Let's talk about treatment. The treatment of chronic pancreatitis. We divide them into two headings: non-operative management and operative management. Non-operative management is a bit of conservative treatment, just like acute pancreatitis, and that include control of abdominal pain, endocrine and exocrine insufficiency management, like if the person is having secondary diabetes, give insulin. Okay, if the person is having malabsorption, probably treat by supplementing pancreatic enzyme and other type of management. Regarding the operative management, we must do preoperative ERCP first to evaluate the anatomy of that area, anatomy of pancreatic duct especially. Okay, so all these are part of the operative management. Pain relief can be done by celiac plexus block. Ampullary procedures can be done with the help of ERCP. With endoscopic sphincterotomy, you divide that sphincter of OD so that if it is causing the obstruction, it is relieved. And we do that with the help of ERCP again. Endoscopic retrograde cholangiopancreatography. That is a full form of ERCP. Ductal decompression procedure is done. Okay, if duct is obstructed because of all those concretions, because of all those calcification, we can go for that. And these are the two, you know, important ductal decompression procedures, like Pusto procedure and Duval procedure. Okay, Pusto procedure is about longitudinal pancreaticojejunostomy, and Duval procedure is retrograde drainage with distal resection. Don't need to know in detail. Nobody is going to ask you about this. This is for the postgraduate student of surgery, not for a label. You just know if duct is blocked, we go for decompression procedure. Okay, don't overstress yourself. But one of the point which is important, I'm going to highlight there. Important thing, I'll tell you what are the things to know at this level. Ablative procedure, like resection of portion of the pancreas, which is very badly destructed or damaged, can be done. Now, that is done again by Frey procedure, Whipple procedure, or near total pancreatectomy. Now, these are the things. Among them, Whipple procedure is quite a common name, which is taken by the surgeon. And so this question can be asked to the student who is doing brilliantly well in the exam. We don't like to ask this difficult type of question in the beginning, you know. If they take the name of Whipple's procedure, that would be enough. But if I want to give some more marks to the student who is doing very good in the exam, then I may ask, do you know something about Whipple's procedure? Can you elaborate on it? Something like that. Now, just listen here. This is a Whipple procedure, also known as pancreaticoduodenectomy. So you sacrifice a part of pancreas and duodenum here. The meaning is that ectomy means removal. It's a complex operation to remove the head of the pancreas, the first part of the small intestine, that is duodenum, the gallbladder, and the bile duct as well. Now, we have removed quite a bit of tissues from there or organs from there. Now, after that, we need to go for re-anastomosis, a reconstruction procedure. Definitely, we cannot simply remove and leave just like that, you know. And that is not the thing. So we have to reconstruct the process or part or organs there. Okay. Now, how to do that? So let me, show you one picture here. See this? This is a Whipple procedure. This is before and this is after. Now, what are the things removed? Look at this color. Okay. Little bit purplish color. These purplish color organs are removed here. So head of the pancreas is removed. This Whipple procedure is very commonly done for head of the pancreatic tumor actually, but it can be done for chronic pancreatitis as well. That's why I am involving it here. Okay, later on, when we talk about cancer of the head of the pancreas, again, Whipple's procedure is one of the treatment there. See this? You sacrifice the head of the pancreas, you sacrifice duodenum, gallbladder, part of the bile duct, also the distal part, the stomach, okay, all these things. Now, this is called reconstruction procedure. Okay. See here, the remaining part of the pancreas is anastomosed here. Okay. The bile duct is anastomosed here, okay, or connected here. So this is the way. And then the remaining part of the stomach is directly anastomosed to the loop of the jejunum, because we have already removed duodenum. So this is called Whipple's procedure. Very difficult type of surgery. And in the field of gastroenterology, if that surgeon can confidently do Whipple procedure, he is considered a very good GI surgeon, because this is a complicated type of surgery. Now, let's move further. What is pseudocyst and how we manage it? Pseudocyst. Pseudocyst, the name itself suggests they are not the true epithelial cyst. Okay, they are non-epithelialized, encapsulated pancreatic fluid collection. They are not covered by epithelium, but there is a capsule formation. And what is the, you know, synthesis? How this capsule is synthesized there? It is because of the organization of exudate. That's why they are known as pseudocyst. Up to 30% of the pseudocysts resolve on their own with bowel rest, like TPN and NPO. What is the full form of these terms? Can you tell me, please?
Total parenteral nutrition and oral.
Excellent. Very good. So total parenteral nutrition and nil per oral. These are the two ways by which we give rest to our bowel. So this pseudocyst can resolve if we do that up to 30% of the time. If after 6 weeks they have not resolved and are more than 6 centimeters in size, then internal drainage, okay, internal drainage of the mature cyst is indicated via cyst gastrostomy or Roux-en-Y cyst jejunostomy. These are a little bit complicated term. See here, cyst gastrostomy means cyst and stomach are connected with each other. So the content of the cyst is drained into the stomach. This is the meaning, gastrostomy. A Roux-en-Y cyst jejunostomy means the reconstruction is done in the form of letter Y. Okay, in the form of letter Y. And the distal segment of that is jejunum. So the content of the cyst will directly go into the jejunum. And why it is reconstructed in this form means to prevent the backflow. If Roux-en-Y, okay, anastomosis is done, then backflow is restricted. So this is, you will know this again in the topic of peptic ulcer disease and carcinoma of the stomach. Okay, this Roux-en-Y anastomosis is done in that case as well. Now, these are the surgical treatment of pseudocyst. If peripancreatic fluid collection is more than 4 weeks, and if they are not going to settle on their own, we have to go for surgical treatment like those cystogastrostomy and Roux-en-Y cystojejunostomy. Okay, another indication is they are big, more than 7 centimeters, and rapidly expanding, and if they are producing some symptoms because of pain, bleeding and infection, and they are getting bigger and bigger, we have to go for surgical management. Now, I have got a few more minutes. So one small part of this big topic is left, that is pancreatic adenocarcinoma. So let's talk about it. Regarding the etiology of this pancreatic adenocarcinoma, or you can also call it pancreatic cancer, okay? Pancreatic cancer. It originates in the exocrine pancreas, that is from the ductal cell. That is the area of origin. And 2/3 of the cancer occurs in the head of the pancreas. So this is a very, very important point here. head of the pancreas, and it is originated from the exocrine part of the pancreas. Now, one common question immediately comes. If it is occurring in the head of the pancreas, what structure is there which is very, you know, closely related with the head of the pancreas? Which structure is there?
Duodenum.
The concavity of duodenum.
Very good. One is duodenum, and another one structure is descending from upwards. What is that? An open
portal vein. Portal vein.
Portal vein.
Portal vein.
Good. I cannot deny your answer. There are three structures. There are three structures which are, you know, present right there. These three structures, which are present on the edge of the lesser omentum, they are common bile duct, portal vein, and hepatic artery. Common bile duct, portal vein, and hepatic artery. And duodenum is already there. You're absolutely correct. Now, just if you know this anatomy, you know, you can write the clinical features on your own. That type of concept I want to provide to my student. You don't need to mug up. Just think about it. What that mass is doing to the common bile duct? It is giving pressure. So there will be obstructive jaundice in the patient. It is giving pressure to the duodenum. So there may be some features of intestinal obstruction as well. There may be pain. Okay. There may be some other features as well, which we are going to talk. Now, the risk factors of pancreatic cancers are male gender. It is common in male, almost two times more common than in female. This is the epidemiological data. Smoking, see that? Tobacco use, two times increased risk than in the general population. Diabetes and alcohol abuse are some other. Alcohol abuse is more important definitely than diabetes. Now, this diabetes is a secondary diabetes. Having said that, this diabetes is usually caused by chronic pancreatitis. Chronic pancreatitis has 20 times more risk, okay, than in general population. Family history, this FH is family history, two times more common. And old age or increased age is also one of the risk factors. So these are some of the non-risk factors. Let's move on. Now, these are the modifiable risk factors: cigarette smoking, okay, exposure to industrial chemicals and toxic metals, high fat, low fiber diet, and overweight and obesity. But many of them, these are hypothetical risk factors. They are not yet proven. Okay. Regarding the signs and symptoms, the person may be having weight loss. This is a cancer. So weight loss is very common. One explanation you can give. And another explanation of weight loss is malabsorption, because this is a disease of pancreas. In disease of pancreas, there is exocrine dysfunction. So with that, there will be malabsorption and diarrhea that also leads to weight loss. So that type of thinking should be coming in your mind. Jaundice, this is because of obstruction of common bile duct, which is in the head of the pancreas. So which type of jaundice is this? Which type?
Obstructive jaundice.
Obstructive jaundice.
Excellent. Excellent. This is obstructive jaundice. You know, there are three types of jaundice: pre-hepatic, hepatic, and post-hepatic or obstructive. This is definitely obstructive type of jaundice. This is a, you know, very deep type of jaundice. Posterior epigastric pain, which is radiating to the back. Okay, if chronic pancreatitis is there along with this malignancy, or the malignancy itself can cause pain because of the pressure. One important feature is migratory thromboflebitis, which is known as Trousseau syndrome. Migratory thromboflebitis or Trousseau syndrome. This Trousseau syndrome is seen especially in tumors of the body or tail of the pancreas rather than the head. So migratory thromboflebitis, this is inflammation of the superficial vein of our body. Superficial veins are inflamed and they are migrating, means different types of vein are involving, you know, when we follow up the patient. For example, 2 days ago, one different vein was affected, and 2 days later, another vein is affected. Means it is migrating, it is fleeting. So this is called Tushu's syndrome. Tumors of the pancreatic tail are usually unresectable because they're asymptomatic during the growth and thus present at a very late stage. Whereas tumor in the head of the pancreas often present earlier because they cause biliary obstruction or jaundice. And patient will come to hospital quite early if the jaundice is there. So prognosis is probably better in head of the pancreas than in the tail. But overall, this is one of the worst cancer to have because prognosis is very poor. Now, how to do the diagnosis? Diagnosis, okay, is done by history, clinical examination, and investigation. Now, all the points are included here. Elevated carcinoembryonic antigen or carbohydrate antigen 99. These are called tumor marker. Very important question from the exam point of view. Okay, so remember, carbohydrate antigen 99 or even carcinoembryonic antigen are utilized as a tumor marker. Tumor marker are used for the diagnostic purpose as well as therapeutic purpose. For example, we have started the treatment of the cancer. The tumor marker level should go down. And during follow-up, if tumor marker levels again increase, what does that mean? The tumor has recurred back. Okay, it is again coming back. CT scan is a study of choice. So CT scan is always done. Percutaneous transhepatic cholangiography or ERCP should be done. Okay, to know the ductal stenosis or ductal obstruction and things like that. And then angiography should also be done. Now, there is one important point regarding the diagnosis that is called Courvoisier sign. This Courvoisier sign is about if a patient presented with obstructive jaundice and the same patient is having palpable non-tender gallbladder, that is known as Courvoisier's law or Courvoisier sign. Now, how that develops? Remember, jaundice with shrunken gallbladder is a feature of chronic cholecystitis or cholelithiasis. During that case, gallbladder is not usually palpable. Rather than that, it is shrunken. Whereas, because of back pressure development, the gallbladder is becoming bigger in size with obstructive jaundice in this type of cases, like carcinoma of head of the pancreas or some other obstructive lesions there. That is called Courvoisier sign. Now, how we are going to treat a case of carcinoma of the head of the pancreas or carcinoma of pancreas altogether. If it is presents in the head, or tumors of the head, the only chance for a cure is the Whipple's procedure. We recently talked about Whipple's procedure, that is known as pancreaticoduodenectomy. Okay, this is a major type of surgery. And most tumors are not resectable at the time of diagnosis, means the patient has presented quite late and there is already extensive local invasion. If tumors of the body or tail is there, then we can go for distal near total pancreatectomy. If it is unresectable due to liver, peritoneal metastasis, nodal metastasis beyond the zone of resection, or tumor invasion of the superior mesenteric artery, then we can go for palliative procedures, okay? Because doing the curative procedure is very damaging for the patient there. So these palliative procedures are relief of the biliary obstruction, relief of duodenal obstruction, and regarding the pain control, we can go for splanchnic nerve block because pain is a major problem there. So we can go for splanchnic nerve block in this type of patient who are beyond the curative phase now. And then the post-operative chemoradiation therapy can be given, but it is controversial. Okay, it is controversial. We typically use 5-fluorouracil and external beam radiation if that is decided to go for. Let's move on. Okay, now this Whipple procedure, we already done Whipple procedure. There is a removal of gallbladder, common bile duct, antrum of the stomach, duodenum, proximal jejunum, and head of the pancreas. They are removed together in block. After that, we do the reconstruction surgery with pancreaticojejunostomy, cholecystectomy, and gastrojejunostomy. What do you mean by that? The remaining part of the pancreas is connected with the loop of jejunum. The remaining part of the common bile duct is connected with the jejunum loop, and the remaining part of the stomach is also connected with the jejunum loop. So this is a reconstructive procedure. Now, what is the prognosis of this patient? The mean survival for patient with unresectable disease is just 4 to 6 months, with a 5-year survival rate of less than 3%. See this? Usually these patients present very late. So they present in the unresectable phase. So mean survival is just 4 to 6 months, with a 5-year survival rate of less than 3%. The median survival for patient who undergo successful resection is approximately 12 to 19 months, with a 5-year survival rate is just 15 to 20%. So this is one of the cancer which is having worst of the prognosis. And many of the time, they die because they present quite late.